Hello, I am Jason Mosery. I'm here at the 2014 New York International Auto Show with Tom Peters from Chevrolet and GM.
I started in 1980, and since then I've been involved with primarily Corvette and Camaro studios, but I've done Buicks, Cadillacs, GMC, Chevrolet trucks over the course of my career. So it's been, I've been very fortunate in that I've had a wide variety of vehicles, and they're each passionate in their own way. But for the most part, Corvettes and Camaros, I've been really fortunate enough to work with some just fantastically talented sculptors and engineers and designers. And again, I can trace it all back to when I was a kid drawing cars, and then you know, we've had a good conversation about as fate would have it, just kind of a coincidence, I've gone to the same schools for at least two of my years of college. You know, at the time it was University of Southwestern Louisiana in Lafayette, and then Louisiana Tech in Ruston. So good memories, actually.
Exactly. And I go to ULL, University of Louisiana at Lafayette, and we have an industrial design program there. I'm also looking to get into automotive design, you know, eventually. So it's interesting that our paths have crossed. And you worked on the trucks too, right?
Yes.
Could you tell me, like, how do you go from designing something like the Corvette to the trucks? Like, is it an easy transition, or do you just...
Mentally, you do have to shift gears, but I will tell you, when you think about it, why do they got you designing trucks and Corvettes at the same time? Well, and then I give that some thought, you know. And when you think about it, just like these cars are high performance, there's a style to them, there's a fashion aspect to them. You want to look good driving it, you have fun, it's exhilarating. Same thing can be said for the trucks. I can tell you firsthand experience, you pull up to a red light, just like you would in a hot car, and another truck pulls up next to you like an F-150 or whatever, and first thing you do, you check out kind of where the belt height is, how big are the wheels and tires, and you know, and then more often than not, a little scoot off the line, you know.
Yeah.
So there's definitely performance aspect of it that's style, a lot of the customers and the drivers are very passionate about them. So you shift gears a little bit, but in many ways they're similar.
Right, exactly, because you have passion for your sports cars, and then you also have people who are passionate about their trucks.
The truck shapes have to be bold and powerful and expressive, and more often than not, they're extensions of the individuals of the driver's personality, and that's very true, I've found.
Right, and as far as like the Corvette, like it's gotten a lot of reaction, the new one, the Stingray versus the old C6. How would you say, when y'all were designing it, like what were the goals of the design, especially with like the Z06 and everything? Like how did you want people to react when they saw this car?
I think you want them to say, wow, that's so different. But yet when they look at it, it doesn't need the badges, doesn't need the graphics, but somehow it says Corvette.
Exactly.
And Stingray. And I think that's always the goal of a designer, to do a shape. Because these aren't 2D images and they're not toasters, you know. They're dynamic sculptures, and I think if you do the design correctly, just by looking at the shape, it expresses a personality, you know. You don't need in your family, you don't need a name badge, they know who you are, you know, by the character and the way you act and your personality and everything. I think these vehicles have to be the same thing. I mean, that's what makes them special.
Oh, yeah. And so one of the things, that's actually one of the classes that I've taken, is we have a forms class. So that's a lot of the process of designing the cars, right? Do you start with the
3D
form, or do you just start off with sketching?
No, we sketch, and there's no set process. You know, people talk, oh, yeah, we use a lot of computers. But I would tell you, the designers, some of them do stuff completely computer. Some of them will draw on a piece of paper or a napkin. Like we're working on a project right now, one of my best designers, he just sketched little pen sketches on ruled paper, notebook paper. And I can take that. That is every bit as useful as someone that does some beautiful high-tech digital rendering in Alias or something, you know? Doesn't matter. As long as that design comes through, the trick is being able to take a look at that and then translate it in 3D, usually scale models in clay. And again, we can design a car totally in the computer. I feel strongly, I've seen it demonstrated, where you have to add that human aspect of it. So I am adamant about we have digital sculptors, but we have hand sculptors that scrape the clay, And that's why I think cars like the Corvette and Camaro, and I'm sure there's many other ones in the industry that are similar, that you have that artistic human quality that comes through the clay and then the sheet metal as well, the body panels. So I think that's very key to having successful design.
And that was one of the questions too, because a lot of the stuff like I'm learning and everything, we're learning a lot of computer modeling, we're learning like good renderings and everything, which is great, but they still want that human aspect, like for you to be able to sit down and sketch something
Whoever is telling you that and instructing that knows what's going on. They've got it going on, and I think that'll be timeless. I wouldn't say that it's impossible to do it all on the computer, because I've done it, but I think it's more difficult. There's some little something that's kind of missing in that. So you have to have this, we use a combination. You know, it's kind of like the digital world in entertainment and making movies. You know, years ago we talked to these folks that were going to do full digital like recreations of, say, Marilyn Monroe.
Oh, wow.
But that's going to happen, but they're not going to do it till it's absolutely flawless. So they're still working on that. So there's no substitute, and you can tell if, you know, the new movie Frozen, you know.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, back then it was all about the hair.
yeah.
And now they're getting really good at it. But still, there are other elements where sometimes if it gets too real, there's an uneasiness about it. So they got to get past that. And once they do, you're probably going to see some of these classic stars star in their own movies again. And so I think this, in a very similar way, automobile design or product design, you still have to have this human quality that people can detect. It may not be readily obvious to them, but they sense it. Us right. As being human beings, and I think that's very important in any kind of design, whether it's a car or a product.
Right, and so even like with 3D modeling and stuff, like you can have it on a computer and see it, but there's a difference when you're actually, you know, have the clay model and you're sculpting it and everything, correct?
That's a whole other thing. You know, we're not doing movies. We're not doing our final product is not a 2D image. It's a three-dimensional sculpted piece of real stuff, and so. That's how you have to look at it. So our goal in designing vehicles, I'm sure it is in product design as well, is as quickly as we can, we try to get it in its finished state. So we take these clay models and we refer to a Dynoc, it's like a decal that goes over it, and we do paper mock-ups and hard mock-ups and get it outside as quickly as possible. That's another key. Getting these things full size, get them outside. We have the capability to project them on full size screens now digitally,
oh, wow.
Which is wonderful. But it's no substitute for taking out and looking at the
like
real
the
property.
Like natural lighting and everything.
Well,
too,
natural
right?
lighting. There's just something about seeing it in 3D and having the atmospheric perspective and the proper lighting, as you say. And you know, think about this. Okay, you see Angelina Jolie in 4K HD on a screen. It's awesome. But how do you think you would react to her if you were talking to her right now next to you and holding a microphone? It's a whole different deal. There's a presence
right.
that has to be captured. And you can do that with this too. There has to be a presence, and you have to understand and work that real time too. Does that make sense?
It definitely does, and it definitely has presence for sure. Like, this car is amazing. So one question I do have for you as well, as far as people who want to design cars, like me, I've wanted to do it since I was, you could write.
Yeah.
So what advice would you give? Like, because when I went to school, like we talked about tech and how we both went there, I was in graphic design. I didn't know what I wanted to do. Like, I knew I wanted to design cars, but I was like, this is not the way.
Right.
Can you kind of give some suggestions about how people can, find, ways to get into the field that they want to?
To me, I think now more than ever, like when I was in going to those schools, most things were communicated through magazines and different, books and things, and maybe a few things on TV, but they never, at least I never saw anything that really specifically addressed this field of design, let alone automobile design. So it was by pure happenstance I came upon, as I mentioned, an Art Center catalog in class one day that a classmate had. But today, it's much more prevalent. I think if you're aware of it, if you have any sort of internet savvy, which every, your 3-year-old has that now, and you probably would have Googled car design.
Yeah, I think so.
And boom, a million things come. There's so many things out there at fingertip reach relative to any field, including design. I think all you got to do is type it in nowadays, and then be bold enough. Two things I would say is, go after your passion and research that, and call people, talk to them person to person, and then another common thing I hear is that, I really can't afford to go to that school. Yes, they are very expensive, but there are so many programs, and I certainly couldn't afford at the time to go to Art Center where I went to, but my mother and I, we researched, my dad wasn't living at the time, we researched grants and scholarships and loans, actually, at the end of the day, I've had a wonderful career, a wonderful life with my family and all that. And that all started with just being, hey, I'm just, and sometimes, you can't help yourself. In my situation, I was compelled to do whatever it took to do this. It reminds me of the movie Close Encounters of the Third Kind, where the guy was compelled to make that Devil's Tower. Even made it out of the mashed potatoes with a fork, and his family thought it was crazy.
Yeah.
I was compelled to draw cars, and once I found out the school was out there, there was nothing going to stop me from getting out to that school. And I remember having a discussion with my mom, saying, well, I got X amount of money, I'm going to give it a shot. I got enough to last me 1 year, I'm going for it. And boom, I packed up and headed to California, never been there, in my car, and it's been a wild adventure.
Wow.
So I would say you just got to be bold and let your passion drive, because you may only get one chance, and you got one life. There's no rehearsal. Yeah. So dive into it. Think of it as an adventure, and you're just going to keep your eyes open, and where there's a will, there's a way, one way or another. And there are people there to help you.
Yeah, that's what I've learned, too.
You're not going to be on your own.
Right, yeah. With like me, like when I decided to go back to school and everything, I didn't even know that, University of Louisiana had industrial design. And when you started, what was your major when you were there?
Well, advertising illustration, there was no industrial design. In fact, I didn't even know those words even existed.
Oh, yeah. That was kind of like me, and it just by chance someone, they have what you're talking about, because I was talking to someone, they have what you're talking about at UL, so.
Yeah, I want to come down and check that out, because again, I'm kind of a sentimental kind of guy, I went back, took my son, I grew up also in Minneapolis until I was about 15. Took him back there. Went to my old schools back there and showed him where I saw my first Corvette and all this stuff. I won't go into that, but I would love to come down there sometime and see that, because it's part of your life. And at my point in my life and my career, I look back and people have asked me, because I've been asked for certain events to trace back what I've done in the past and what got me to where I'm at now. And when you lay it out, and you don't know, you're just experiencing it at a time, but you see there's like a method to the madness, and each opportunity that you got, each experience that you got kind of led you to this, and somebody had some kind of a plan that you track. I tell you what, that's wild.
Yeah, and it all like comes together.
You see pictures and artwork, yeah, it all comes together.
It all connects. And like, have you always felt like, like one of the things with me was like I felt like almost like I was born, like this is what I was born
me
to
too.
Do. That's how you felt,
yep.
And
yep.
That's what
yep.
gave you the mm-hmm. passion to mm-hmm. kind of go do whatever you had to make it, right?
Yep. I felt there. Yeah, after seeing this laid out, you see there's some kind of method to this. There's some kind of plan, and here I am, and I'm made to do this.
Awesome.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
That's one of the things that our one of our professors, Jerry Malinowski, who worked on the original Mustang,
he told me.
I was like, I just don't, it's so competitive. I was like, I don't know how it's going to happen when, I graduate. And he's like, well, I wanted to do it, and I did it. Mm-hmm. And that was enough, So just go for your dream.
Dive in. Last night I was watching some show on TV. I think it was Good Morning America or whatever. And they showed this gal diving off this building and one of these kind of a giant bungee jump thing. I don't know if it was in Las Vegas or whatever, there's a term for it. But it's kind of like that. You got to take the leap.
Take the
leap
dive.
Leap of faith. Take the dive. Take the dive, because you get one chance.
Exactly. Hello, I am Jason Mosery. I'm here at the 2014 New York International Auto Show with Tom Peters from Chevrolet and GM. I don't know what to say.
That's great. That's good.